Greetings. My topic today is entitled, Science is My Religion, The Electron is God, and Scientists Are Prophets. Once again, my topic is entitled, Science is My Religion, The Electron is God, and Scientists Are Prophets. So let us begin. I come to you today not as a Muslim nor a Christian, not as a Hebrew nor a Jew, not as a Buddhist nor a Hindu, not as an atheist nor agnostic. No, I do not come to you today as a member of any religion, sect, cult, group, or organization. I simply come to you today in the same way in which we were all born into this world, as a human being endowed with senses to experience the world around us, and a mind that uses logic and reason to process and make sense of our experiences so that we can make the best choices in life and plan the best course of action. And with that simple realization that this is the way we all come into the world, I bear witness to the reality that we are all born scientists. You see, science at its root, at its core, at its essence, is nothing more than a systematic observation and study of nature, for the purpose of gaining knowledge and understanding and making predictions. You see, it is the predictive power of scientific theories, the ability for science to forecast, foretell, and foresee what will happen next, either 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, or 100 years into the future. It is the predictive power of science which makes me make the bold claim that scientists are prophets. The definition and function of the word prophet is one who prophesizes or foretells prophecies, one who predicts the future. So based on this definition, it is right to say that scientists are prophets. When the meteorologist forecasts the weather for the coming week, he or she is literally functioning as a prophet. When the climatologist predicts global warming and rising sea levels, they are functioning as prophets. When the astronomer predicts solar eclipses, lunar eclipses, and planetary alignments, they are functioning as prophets. Also, the etymological origin of the word shaman means to know. Also, the etymological origin of the word scientist means to know. So I could also say that scientists are shaman. However, whereas a shaman is primarily concerned with altered states of consciousness to gain knowledge of the spiritual world, scientists are primarily concerned with using and maintaining logical and reasonable states of consciousness to gain knowledge of the natural world. You know, a synonym to the word prophecy is the word prescience. Prescience, or as some say, prescience, means knowledge of future events, literally a prophecy. But you see, the word science is the root of the word, because one of the primary functions of scientists is to serve as prophets, to provide prophecies, to make predictions. But the difference between prophets in science and prophets in traditional religion is that, unlike traditional religion, where only a certain small select group of people are said to have the power of prophecy, in science, anyone who studies and practices science and follows the scientific method will have the ability to harness the predictive power of science to scientifically prophesize, so to speak. And as I previously mentioned, we are all born into this world as scientists. You are a scientist before you are any of the things that you identify yourself as. Before you belong to any religion, you are a scientist. Before you knew you were black, you were a scientist. Before you knew you were a boy or girl, male or female, you were a scientist. Before you were Christian, Hebrew, Kemetic, African, whatever you identify with, before you were any of those things, you were a scientist. Well, why do you say I was a scientist before any of these things, you may ask? Because in order to identify with any of those things in the first place, you had to been a scientist first. You had to have observed yourself, observed your surroundings, understood the definitions of things, and then make a conclusion and say, hey, yes, I am a male. I am a female. I am, based on your observations. You made a hypothesis, you made an educated guess, and you came to a conclusion. That is the scientific method. So before you were anything that you identified with, you were a scientist. We were all born scientists. See, science is methodical, it's systematic, it's rigorous and organized. In the world of religion and spirituality, religion is organized and systematic. Religion is formal. Spirituality is informal. The religious person has a schedule. They have a set methodology. a system that they have to follow if they say that they belong to a certain religion. And if they do not follow that methodology, if they do not follow that system, if they deviate in any way, they have a peer group who will hold them accountable. Sister, I didn't see you at the church last Sunday. Brother, I didn't see you at the masjid last Friday. Sister, you know you're not supposed to be wearing that. Oh, brother, you know you're not supposed to be eating that. There is a system of accountability, just like in science. See, I talk a lot about the scientific method, making a hypothesis, performing experiments, or exposing yourself to experiences to gain evidence either supporting or refuting your hypothesis, observing the results and coming to a conclusion, the scientific method. So in this way, science is like religion, because religion has a specific order, system, methodology, and accountability. And science has a specific order, system, methodology, and accountability. This is why I say science is my religion. You know, one of the definitions of the word religion is a pursuit or interest to which someone ascribes supreme importance. Well, to me, science is a pursuit or interest to which I ascribe supreme importance. Science is my religion. You see, every race of people on this planet has contributed to the body of knowledge that is science. Science is the only doctrine that everyone has contributed to, and the only doctrine that everyone can agree on because it works. Science is like a one-world religion. In the religion of Christianity, there's a Trinity, three in one, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Well, in science, you have a quaternity, four in one. The quaternity is represented by the four letters, S-T-E-M. Those four letters, S-T-E-M, stand for two sets of words. The first set of words represents the component parts of nature, space, time, energy, and matter. These four words describe everything there is in nature and the universe. In the science called physics, which means nature, you learn about the space-time continuum in astrophysics on the macrocosmic scale. And then you learn about the matter-energy continuum given by the equation E equals mc squared in relativistic or quantum physics on the microcosmic scale. Space, time, energy, and matter, STEM, everything in nature and the universe. Show me something that cannot be classified as either space, time, energy, or matter. The second set of words that the four letters STEM represent are science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. These are the disciplines, the schools of thought, dedicated to studying and understanding nature and harnessing, controlling, and working with the laws of nature. Science is the father, the discipline that generates the theories and explanations about nature. Mathematics is the Holy Spirit, the abstraction that enables us to describe and understand nature and the universe. Mathematics is the language of the universe. Mathematics is the language of science. Every religion has its language. They say, if you cannot speak the language of Hebrew, you cannot really understand the Bible. If you cannot speak the language of Arabic, you cannot really understand the Quran, and you have no place to teach or comment about the religion of Islam. If you cannot read the Meduneter, then you can't really understand Kemet, and you have no right to teach or comment about ancient Kemet. Then it follows, if you do not know mathematics, which is the language of science and the universe, if you do not know the fundamental theorem of algebra or the fundamental theorem of calculus, for example, then you have no right to teach or talk about science. So in the religion of STEM, science is the father. Mathematics is the Holy Spirit, the language, the word of science. The letter E stands for engineering. Engineering is the Blessed Mother. Engineering is the discipline which is dedicated to practical application. The discipline which brings forth, which gives birth to technology, the letter T, which is the product, the sun, which came into existence by way of science, math, and engineering. The letters STEM stand for space, time, energy, and matter, all of nature and the universe, represented by the circle. And the letters STEM stand for science, technology, engineering, and math, the study, comprehension, and practical application of the study of nature, represented by the square. It is through the scientific study of ourselves, the scientific study of the human mind and human behavior, through fields such as anthropology, evolutionary biology, and psychology, that we are able to derive the science of morality and develop a code of morals and ethics by which we are able to govern our deeds, conduct, and actions. Science literally provides you with a means to know thyself. Science also provides you with the means to know thy environment. And science provides you with the means to know God. See, science deals with theories. Mathematics deals with theorems. But religion deals with theos, or God. Theory, theorem, theos. Three T's, triple tau, all sharing a common root origin. But the definition of God specifically comes from religion, where religion defines God based on seven characteristics. One, divine simplicity, meaning not consisting of any parts. Two, omnipresence, meaning present everywhere. Three, omniscient, meaning all-knowing. Four, omnipotent, meaning all-powerful. Five, omnibenevolent, meaning all-good. Six, creator, sustainer, and destroyer. And seven, giver of life and bringer of death. Now, based on this religious definition of God, through scientific investigation, we find that the electron is the only empirical object which satisfies all the criteria. The electron is a fundamental particle, so it meets the criteria of divine simplicity, not consisting of any parts or substructure. The electron is in all matter, so everywhere there is something, there is at least one or more electrons, so the electron is omnipresent. The characteristic of God called omniscience means all-knowing. And since knowledge or information is processed and transmitted in our brains by neurons sending electrons as electrical signals, then literally everything that is known is facilitated by way of electrons. And not just biologically, but all information and knowledge, even knowledge stored in computers, is facilitated by way of electrons. So the electron is omniscient. The electron is omnipotent. Now, we recognize that omnipotence in and of itself is a logical paradox. So instead of talking about something being all-powerful, let's talk about what is the most powerful. In physics, power is the rate at which a force does work. All the forces in the universe are based on the four fundamental forces, and electrons participate in three of the four fundamental forces: gravitation, electromagnetism, and the electroweak force. So the electron is the most powerful in that it participates in three of the four fundamental forces. The electron is omnibenevolent, all good, because goodness is defined as always adhering to a set of rules, laws, and codes, and the electrons always adhere to a specific set of scientific rules or equations. The electron is creator. The exchange or sharing of electrons between two or more atoms is the main cause of chemical bonding, which creates the molecules of all substances. Conversely, the chemical reactions which destroy or transform one substance to another involves the loss or change in the position of electrons. So the electron is simultaneously creator and destroyer. Lastly, the electron gives life. Life is a characteristic of a physical entity having biological processes, and biological processes are any number of chemical reactions that result in a transformation. Chemical reactions are caused by the loss or change in position of electrons. Conversely, the cessation of chemical reactions is when electrons stop flowing, and this is what brings about death. So as you see, the electron is God. So as I end my sermon on science today, I would like to emphasize that science, technology, engineering, and math are the keys to survival, well-being, freedom, and liberation. As I previously mentioned, we are all born scientists, and we were scientists before we were anything that we identify ourselves with. It was and is through science that we were and are able to survive. The way our ancestors knew which plants to eat and which plants not to eat was through science, trial and error, experimentation. The way our ancestors knew where to go, where to migrate to, which places to avoid, and which places to settle in was through science. You must comprehend that you are here today. Your very existence, your very subsistence, your very life was made possible through science. You are the result of a long series of continuously successful scientific experiments carried out by your ancestors, going all the way back from multicellular organisms to single-celled organisms to atoms, the elements, to the very fundamental particles of nature, like the electron, who is God and dwells within each of us. The moment you abandon science is the moment you start courting extinction. The moment you abdicate science, you pursue your own elimination and annihilation. But the moment that you advocate for science, the moment that you decide to actively start using and practicing science, when we have an enthusiastic passion for science, a dedicated appreciation for science, a religious devotion and zeal for science, then we will see ourselves begin to truly thrive, prosper, and succeed. Oh, I can do all things through science who strengthens me. So, let us use our minds to discover the science to accept the things we cannot change, technology to engineer the things we can, and the mathematics to know the difference.